subject for today, which is business as usual, with the intriguing subtitle, Why the RAF Paid Royalties to IG Farben, the manufacturer of Cyclone B, or Cyclone B, which is, of course, was the gas used in the gas chambers throughout World War II. I'm sure you've all heard of Chaim Weizmann. Chaim Weizmann was the Russian-born Jewish scientist and British Zionist leader who would later become Israel's first president. And at the beginning of World War I, Weizmann's friend C.P. Scott, the editor and owner of the Manchester Guardian, helped secure Weizmann a job as a chemist in the Ministry of Munitions. One day, in the summer of 1916, the Minister of Munitions, Lloyd George, later, of course, Prime Minister Lloyd George, happened to mention over lunch to Scott that the British were experiencing a shortage of acetone, and this shortage of acetone was hampering the war effort. German submarines were sinking eastbound cargo convoys, and the Royal Navy's capacity to retaliate was diminished because of a shortage of cordite, the propellant used to fire shells. The cordite shortage was due to a shortage of acetone, a chemical which could no longer, of course, be imported from Germany. Well, said Scott to Lloyd George, what a coincidence. Just last week, our friend Professor Weizmann said to me he had developed a way of producing acetone in industrial quantities. So quickly, Weizmann was rushed to a meeting with British scientists from the War Ministry, and he told them he needed to process large quantities of anything with cellulose in it, like maize. But maize was very difficult to get hold of because that had to come from Canada and, of course, therefore was subject to the same problems of transport that were bedeviling the British Navy. So, said Weizmann, if you can't give me maize, give me chestnuts. Also have this cellulose material in it. The word went out, and children all over Britain were told to collect chestnuts. And sackfuls of chestnuts, thousands of tons of chestnuts, were sent to a premises in London that used to be a gin distillery, and that's where Weizmann managed to produce in large quantities the acetone that was needed for the propellant, and therefore, from that late summer, the tide turned, excuse the pun, in the War of the Atlantic, and British ships started sinking German submarines after far too long a period where they had not been able to. And I tell you this story about how Weizmann responded when his adopted country faced wartime shortages of essential materials in the First World War, by way of introduction to my theme this evening, how American industry responded to wartime shortages in the Second World War. I want to introduce you to a gentleman who I doubt anyone here has heard of, Justin Hilary O'Byrne. I think we might guess his origins. But actually, he was a Labour senator in Tasmania, Australia, between 1946 and 1981. One of his claims to fame is that he was publicly denounced by the Catholic Archbishop Guildford Young for supporting, God save us, divorce legislation. In 1940, O'Byrne enlisted in the Royal Australian Air Force, went to Ottawa for his pilot training, and was stationed as an RAF pilot in Britain. When his Spitfire was shot down over France in 1941, he bailed out, was captured by the Germans, and spent time in the same hospital as the legendary Douglas Bader. Some of you will know him from my favorite movie, Reach for the Sky. Douglas Bader was the pilot who lost both his legs before the war, insisted on flying with his artificial legs, and got shot down without his legs. And before the RAF parachuted limbs for him into Germany, which they did and which he eventually got, O'Byrne used to carry Bader on his back. O'Byrne emerged from 4 years as a prisoner of war as a confirmed opponent of the capitalist system. And in 1948, this former RAF pilot stands up in the Tasmanian Senate and he says, "During World War II, the capitalist system forced the RAF to pay royalties for its fuel to Standard Oil of New Jersey, and these royalties found their way to Nazi Germany." This was quite a statement to make, and yet it is not a statement that too many people have ever heard of. And this was, of course, the stimulus for me to start looking into this, what sounded like a crazy claim. "The Germans," said O'Byrne, "profited from every gallon of aviation fuel used by the RAF. And these same royalties," said O'Byrne, "eventually reached IG Farben, Interessengemeinschaft Farbenindustrie, the manufacturer of the notorious Zyklon B lethal gas used to murder millions in Auschwitz and elsewhere." So this evening we will explore Senator O'Byrne's claims. Earlier, I showed how in World War I, Weizmann put his industrial knowledge at the disposal of Britain. It would seem logical and reasonable to assume that in World War II, United States companies, which were among the most advanced in the world, would step up to the mark. And yet, instead of coming to the rescue of the USA, far too many major American corporations actually hampered the war effort. I've already mentioned IG Farben. Without IG Farben's immense production facilities, far-reaching research, technical know-how, and immense economic power, it is very unlikely that Germany could have been able to start its aggressive war in September 1939. And here is a fact about IG Farben you may be surprised to hear. The company owed its size and power to Wall Street. In 1924, American banks arranged foreign loans totaling $800 million. $800 million in 1924 was a lot of money. To consolidate gigantic chemical and steel combinations into cartels. And in 1927, the Rockefeller-owned Standard Oil, the largest oil company in the world, embarked on a cooperative program of research and development of the hydrogenation process with IG Farben. And in 1929, the two companies signed a cartel agreement whereby Standard Oil got one half of all the rights to the hydrogenation process in all countries of the world except Germany. In addition, the agreement stipulated that they would never compete, I'm quoting, never to compete with each other in the fields of chemistry and petroleum products. In the future, if Standard Oil wished to enter the broad field of industrial chemicals or drugs, it would do so only as a partner of Farben. Farben, in turn, agreed never to enter the field of petroleum except as a joint venture with Standard Oil. After Germany invaded Austria in March 1938, after the Anschluss, IG Farben asked the Ethyl Gasoline Corporation, owned jointly by General Motors and Standard Oil, to build tetraethyl plants in Germany with the full support of the US Department of War, which raised no objections. And this is after the Anschluss. Standard Oil helped Hermann Schmitz of IG Farben to acquire 500 tons of tetraethyl lead from ethylene in 1939. Schmitz obtained a further $20 million worth of tetraethyl lead, which was then used for making aviation fuel back in Germany. Ethyl Gasoline Corporation is the same company that later created IG Auschwitz, a huge slave labor camp that produced artificial rubber and gasoline from coal using proprietary patents granted by Standard Oil. So Standard Oil and IG Farben provided the capital and the technology, and Hitler supplied the slave labor, political prisoners, and Jews. Over 25,000 camp inmates died during the construction of this IG Auschwitz, which used as much electricity as the entire city of Berlin. We're talking about a mega project here. Later in 1939, when Britain and Germany were already at war, I repeat, the war had already started between Britain and Germany, Frank Howard, an American vice president of Standard Oil New Jersey, reported to William Stamps Farish, the head of Standard Oil, that he had renewed the business relationship with IG Farben using Royal Dutch Shell mediation to provide an additional layer of secrecy. Howard explicitly stated that such an agreement would continue even if Germany and the United States went to war. It was as explicit as that. Not unnaturally, Britain complained about US shipments of strategic materials to Nazi Germany after the war had started. So what did Standard Oil do? Change the registration of their entire fleet to Panamanian to avoid British search or seizure. These ships continued to carry oil to Tenerife in the Canary Islands, where they refueled and siphoned oil to German tankers for shipment to Hamburg. Ladies and gentlemen, this is after World War II has started between Britain and Germany. This deception was exposed on March the 31st, 1941, when the US State Department listed Standard Oil of New Jersey and Standard Oil of California as using refueling stations in Mexico and Central and South America that were suspected of furnishing oil to Italian and German merchant vessels. In March 1942, Farish and other officers of Standard Oil and related companies pleaded no contest to criminally conspiring with a Nazi government in Germany. And as part of a plea bargain, the charges were dropped in exchange for Standard Oil releasing its German patents. I learned much of this information from a book by a gentleman called Gunter Reimann. Gunter Reimann was a German Jewish Marxist economist who had sought refuge in the USA before the war. But prior to that, I see that someone has heard of Reimann. Prior to that, Reimann had written a book while still in London in which he exposed the iniquities of the Nazi economy. Reimann, by the way, went on to found a weekly newsletter for a group of subscribers, central banks, embassies, government ministries, and the head offices of Fortune 500 companies, who paid about $6,000 a year for the privilege of getting his newsletter, and this is $6,000 in the late 1940s and early 50s. A friend of mine, some of you may have heard of him, an Irish Jew who now lives in New York, called Sam Citron, worked for a while as Reimann's salesman. I happened to be talking to Sam yesterday. He must have heard that I was giving this talk. And I said, Sam, this was all your fault because you had told me about Reimann's book. And he also told me that he helped sell a large quantity of these subscriptions So this is the Marxist economist who became a multimillionaire. Yeah, funny old world. Now, for our purposes, the important thing about Ryman is that in 1942, now living in New York, he wrote a book called Patents for Hitler, with an introduction by a gentleman with the exotic name of Creekmore Fath, General Counsel of the Senate Committee on Patents. And this is what Fath wrote in his introduction. Since the middle 30s, whenever a German business group wanted to make an agreement with any business concern beyond the borders of Germany, it was required first to submit a full text of the proposed agreement to the Reichsbank. The Reichsbank rejected or rewrote until the agreement met its approval. The Reichsbank approved no agreement which did not fit into the plans of the Nazi state, so that any American firm which reached an agreement or dealt with a German firm was dealing with Hitler himself. And the main thrust of Ryman's book is that these agreements retarded technological advances and impeded war production in the United States. That's a pretty heavy accusation. I think it was Stalin who said that the war was decided by aircraft engines and octane. One major technical advantage that Britain enjoyed over Germany was that the RAF used high-grade petroleum products, particularly 100 octane plus petrol. The strategic air offensive depended on Britain's access to large stocks of high-grade refined petroleum. Attempts to produce 100 octane petrol domestically in Britain were a dismal failure. And throughout the war, the Air Ministry had to purchase fuel for its RAF fleet from Standard Oil of New Jersey. And that is what Senator Byrne meant when he stood up in the Tasmanian Senate in 1948. For every gallon of fuel used by the RAF, royalties made their way to IG Farben because Standard Oil insisted on honoring its patent royalty contracts with IG Farben, war or no war. I want to give you a few examples, other examples of strange to us goings-on. I want to start with synthetic rubber. In the late 1930s, long before the fall of Singapore and long before Pearl Harbor, the West was already worried about supplies of natural rubber. By 1939, America's armed services were hard put to complete wheels for the planes, tanks, and armored cars. There was an urgent need for synthetic rubber. The company that held the technology for synthetic rubber was Esso. Now, many of us grew up with Esso, so all sorts of, can't remember the tune. Someone remember the tune? That's right, yes. Now, what many of us never knew is that Esso is S-O, Standard Oil. William Farish, the president of Standard Oil, admitted that in September 1941, the Rubber Corporation, that's the division of the Government Reconstruction Finance Corporation, instructed Standard to suspend all work on the government butadiene project for 1 year. Why? Why would Standard Oil not rush to help the USA government produce an alternative to natural rubber? Why? Because war or no war, Standard Oil was not prepared to violate its arrangement with IG Farben. Hitler was able to obtain certain kinds of standard artificial rubber, but not America. In the war, I'm talking about. When World War II broke out in September 1939, Farish sent Frank Howard to London for an urgent meeting with US Ambassador Joseph P. Kennedy, father, of course, of John Kennedy, who, as we know, wanted to negotiate a separate peace that would bring the European war to an immediate end. Kennedy enthusiastically approved Howard's request to meet Farben's representative, Fritz Ringer, in Holland. So let's just get this right. There's a war on. This American guy is trying to get a meeting with his Farben associate, and Kennedy helps get Howard to fly to The Hague, which was still neutral, in September, late September 1939. He even organized a special RAF bomber for the occasion, which I find very ironic. And at the Hague meeting, held in the Standard Oil offices, Ringer handed over a thick bundle of German patents that were locked into standard agreements so that they would not be seized in water. The two men agreed to remain in business together, I quote, whether or not the United States came into the war, unquote. This is a meeting held in The Hague after the war has started. Another clause in the agreement guaranteed that the moment the war was over, IG Farben would get back its patents. Kennedy arranged for the patents to be flown by American diplomatic bag from The Hague to Ambassador William Bullitt in Paris, of course Paris still unoccupied, who forwarded them on by special courier to Farish in New York. And in case future investigators would question an agreement made after Britain and Germany were ready at war, Kennedy fraudulently backdated the agreement to 3 weeks before the war started. So that I did nothing. That's not the end of the rubber scandal. In the mid-1940s, Jesse Jones, head of the Reconstruction Finance Corporation and the Government's Defense Plants Corporation, was urged to facilitate expansion of synthetic rubber production. I told you that there was a shortage. Standard Oil persuaded Jones that America had sufficient crude rubber stocks, even if all imports were cut off, to meet the country's needs for more than a year of war, and this was a blatant lie. A year later, Jones finally agreed to start an experimental program for producing 40,000 tons of synthetic rubber, and when Singapore was about to fall, Jones informed the Truman Committee that he was making plans for the production of 400,000 tons of synthetic rubber, and they would be ready in 3 years' time in 1944. Standard Oil also hoodwinked the American government into believing that its butyl rubber process, which it had made available to IG Farben, was not the best or the cheapest synthetic rubber process available. This was again an absolute outright lie. Standard Oil's own documentation shows that butyl was superior in all respects to natural rubber. Yet as Jones testified before the Truman Committee, Standard Oil had not encouraged any of us in the belief that butyl rubber was a success. Standard Oil officials at the time claimed that butyl was too costly to produce. Standard Oil's own files showed that it cost only 6.6 cents a pound, as compared to the 21 cents a pound being charged by the British and Dutch interests for crude rubber. It wasn't just synthetic rubber, it was aluminium. For 2 years prior to America's entry into the war, Alcoa, the Aluminium Corporation of America, or the Aluminum, I should say, a Corporation of America, repeatedly assured the government that no new plants were necessary. And in reality, the acute shortage of aluminium resulted from the deliberate efforts of Alcoa. Congressman Pierce of Oregon told the Truman Committee in May 1941, to date, 137 days, or 37.5% of a year's production has been wasted in the effort to protect Alcoa's monopolistic position. This delay, translated into planes, means 10,000 fighters or 1,665 bombers. The Truman Committee report in June 1941 said, I quote, "For months, the Defense Advisory Commission and the Office of Production Management had said that talk about a shortage of aluminium was misleading and it was unpatriotic to talk about the possibility of such a shortage. The Office of Production Management had apparently completely relied on Alcoa as a source of information as to the availability of aluminium and had discouraged anyone else from going into the business of producing aluminium. Alcoa had long followed a policy of maintaining high prices and building new capacity only when certain it could sell at its fixed prices all that would be produced." And indeed, when Alcoa did finally permit the erection of new plants at government expense, it received the lion's share of the contracts. These new plants did not reach full production until 1943, and failed to produce sufficient aluminium for the country's civilian and military needs. Let's look at tungsten carbide, the finest and cheapest metal alloy for the use of cutting tools. General Electric, which controlled the patents on tungsten carbide, informed the German Krupp Steel Trust at the time of the signing of its cartel agreement that GE desired to limit American licenses, I quote, "to a small number, preferably not more than two." And in fact, it was limited to just one, which was GE's own subsidiary called Carbaloy. GE's agreement even gave Krupp the right to determine which companies GE may license. So although General Electric was manufacturing tungsten carbide at a cost of $6.50 a pound, it maintained a price as high at times as $453 a pound and never less than $200 a pound. Let's look at tetracene, the best and most easily produced chemical agent for ammunition priming. The tetracene patents were jointly owned by Remington Arms, a DuPont subsidiary, and IG Farben. According to the agreement between the two, Remington could not license the United States and British governments to produce tetracene, nor could Remington or any of its private licensees produce tetracene to be used for war purposes by the American government or in ammunition sold to the British government. That's right. DuPont was more concerned with honoring its agreement with IG Farben than with helping the Allies win the war. Another DuPont subsidiary, Rohm and Haas, maintained a monopoly on synthetic glass by cartel agreement with IG Farben. After Pearl Harbor, the company set aside royalties on US military orders for post-war payment to the German interests. Understand this mindset. There's world war. Everyone is now at war. And the company is setting aside royalties for a rainy day to give back to IG Farben. Under its agreement with IG Farben, DuPont fixed prices so high as to prevent any independent production of vital dyestuffs. And according to Thurman Arnold, chief competition lawyer of the United States government and the instigator of numerous studies to support the antitrust efforts in the late 1930s, DuPont's price fixing not only resulted in high prices to the American consumer, but also restricted the full development of the chemical industry, which is essential to the US war effort. I'm telling you things that are available, they're out there, they're known, but they're certainly not known very well. Let's go back to Standard Oil, which had agreements with IG Farben covering acetylene and acetic acid, the best and cheapest raw material base for rayons, plastics, paints, dyes, and other important chemical products. Jasco Inc., a holding company owned jointly by Standard Oil and its Nazi cartel partner, had built an acetylene plant in Baton Rouge. At the insistence of IG Farben, the Baton Rouge plant was closed down prior to World War II and was later completely demolished by Standard Oil. There are plenty of other examples. The Chase Bank in Nazi-occupied Paris after Pearl Harbor was doing millions of dollars worth of business with the enemy with the full knowledge of the Chase head office in Manhattan. Ford trucks were being built for the German occupation troops in France with authorization from Dearborn, Michigan. Ford, via Ford Werke AG, which made trucks and light armored vehicles in Cologne, which involved labor from the nearby Buchenwald camp and Kampen also in Berlin. The American telephone conglomerate ITT purchased a substantial interest in Fokker Wolf, an airplane manufacturer. ITT was helping to produce German fighter aircraft used later to kill Allied pilots. The founder of ITT, Colonel Sothenes Ben, flew from New York to Spain onto Switzerland in the middle of the war to help, this is an American we're talking about, to help improve Hitler's communication systems and improve the robot bombs that devastated London. General Motors, German subsidiary Opel, manufactured trucks, engines, light armored vehicles, tanks, and airplanes. General Motors supplied data on automatic pilots, aircraft instruments, and aircraft and diesel engine starters. Kodak had factories in both Germany and occupied France and continued to do business with Germany until 1943 via its Swiss branch. Such arrangements were known about in Washington and either sanctioned or deliberately ignored. The Bank for International Settlements, BIS, in Switzerland, was a joint creation in 1930 of the world's central banks, including the Federal Reserve Bank of New York. Its existence was inspired by, I hope I find those again, a gentleman called Halma Horace Greeley Schacht, who was president of the Reichsbank and later Nazi Minister of Economics. Sensing Hitler's lust for power and conquest, even before Hitler rose to power, Schacht pushed for an institution that would retain channels of communication and collusion between the world's financial leaders, even in the event of an international conflict. It was written into the bank's charter that the BIS should be immune from seizure, closure or censure, whether or not its owners were at war. These owners included First National Bank of New York, the Bank of England, the Reichsbank, the Bank of Italy, the Bank of France, and other central banks. BIS's ostensible purpose was to provide the Allies with reparations to be paid by Germany after World War I. In fact, the bank became a money funnel for American and British funds to flow into Hitler's coffers and to help Hitler build up his war machine. The BIS was completely under Hitler's control by the outbreak of World War II. Among the directors were Hermann Schmitz, head of IG Farben, Baron Kurt von Schroeder, head of the J.H. Stein Bank in Cologne, and a leading officer and financier of the Gestapo. Two others, Walter Funk of the Reichsbank and Emil Pohl, were Hitler's personal appointees to the bank's board. And thus it was on a bright May morning in 1944, I repeat, 1944, just a year before the war ends, while Allied soldiers were dying in Europe and Asia, Thomas Harrington McKittrick, the American president of the Nazi-controlled BIS, arrived at his Bâle office to preside over a fourth annual meeting in time of war. That's right, in the middle of the war, McKittrick sat down with his German, Japanese, Italian, British, and American executive staff to discuss such important matters as the $378 million in gold that had been sent by the bank to the bank by the Nazi government after Pearl Harbor for use by its leaders after the war. Gold that had been looted from the national banks of Austria, Holland, Belgium, and Czechoslovakia, or melted down from the Reichsbank holdings of the teeth filings, spectacle frames, cigarette cases and lighters, and wedding rings of murdered Jews. You may have noticed one company missing from this list, IBM. I know you've all heard of the Wannsee Conference, organized by Heydrich and Eichmann in January 1942, which endorsed the final solution, including, of course, the murder of Ireland's 4,000 Jews. But did you know that the Wannsee Conference was attended by two experts from the Hollerith company? Hollerith is the punch card division of IBM. That's right. IBM experts actually attended and participated in the Wannsee Conference. The driving force behind IBM's support for the Nazis was its chairman, the legendary Thomas Watson, who valued Germany as the largest market after the US. During the 1930s, he micromanaged Dehomark, which is IBM's subsidiary, and saw IBM's German profits soar. In recognition of Watson's support, Hitler awarded him the Merit Cross of the German Eagle in 1937. IBM's Hollerith punch cards contain standardized holes, each representing a different variable to be measured. The card would then be fed into a reader machine, which tabulated the specific series of punched holes. For the entire 12 years of the German Reich, IBM placed its technology at the disposal of Hitler's program of Jewish destruction and territorial domination. In the German census of 1933, the Hollerith provided profession by profession, city by city, and block by block revelation of the Jewish presence. A Hollerith department operated in nearly every concentration camp, and Hollerith tracked forced laborers at Flossenbürg and other slave labor camps. Without IBM's machinery and constant supply of punch cards, the Holocaust could never have consumed the numbers it did. And even after the United States entered the war, IBM as a company knew the innermost details of Hitler's Hollerith operations, designing the programs, printing the cards, and servicing the machines. IBM subsidiaries traded directly with Germany and Italy. It was business as usual throughout the war. When IBM was investigated by the FBI for its Nazi connections and by a Justice Department official for possible monopolistic practices and trading with the enemy, the investigations were soon called off. IBM was untouchable. And by 1943, both sides could not afford to proceed without the company's all-important technology. Hitler needed IBM, and so did the Allies. To conclude, I don't think you have to be a confirmed Marxist economist like Gunther Reimann to realize that during World War II, behind the patriotic propaganda that encouraged the working class to slaughter each other in the interests of competing national interests, international capital quietly kept the commodity circuits flowing and profits growing across all borders. Too many major American companies were more concerned with their patents and royalties than with helping win the war against Germany and Japan. And if you ask me what were the common denominators of the business-as-usual ideology of these American tycoons, I would say there were three. Greed, admiration for Hitler, and anti-Semitism. We cannot let the US government off too lightly either. William Dodd, US ambassador to Germany between 1933 and 1937, clearly saw the danger posed by Hitler and Nazism, and he tried to warn President Roosevelt. I'm going to quote for a few minutes from what he actually wrote to Roosevelt. At the present moment, more than 100 American corporations have subsidiaries here or cooperative understandings. The DuPonts have their allies in Germany that are aiding in the armament business. Their chief ally is IG Farben, a part of the government which gives 200,000 marks a year to one propaganda organization operating on American opinion. IG Farben financed propaganda campaigns on American soil. Standard Oil is still Dodd speaking. Standard Oil Company sent $2 million here in 1933 and has made $500,000 a year helping Germans make ersatz gas, that's the hydrogenation process of converting coal to gasoline, for war purposes, but Standard Oil cannot take any of its earnings out of the country except in goods. The International Harvester Company president told me that their business has risen 33% a year in arms manufacture, but they can take nothing out. Even our airplane people have secret arrangements with Krupps. Lastly, said General Motors Company and Ford do enormous business here through their subsidiaries and take no profits out. Roosevelt's response, as I have learned recently, you get rid of troublemakers and whistleblowers. So what did Roosevelt do? He sacked Dodd. As a postscript, I want to pose a question relating to the bombing targets of the Allies. I'm not going to go into the wider question of why didn't Britain and America bomb the railway lines to Auschwitz. Definitely a subject that we could spend an evening talking about. But a senior US military officer claimed after World War II that IG Farben had a secret arrangement with the top US military brass to go easy on bombing Farben's facilities during the war. At the close of the conflict, after all the years of Allied bombing, Farben's facilities were 93% untouched and intact. Go work that one out. Germany's electrical equipment industry was concentrated into a few major corporations linked in an international cartel and by stock ownership to General Electric and ITT. Their industrial plants were never a prime target for bombing in World War II, and the only electrical equipment plants that were targets were not affiliated with US companies. The German General Electric plant at Koppelsdorf, Germany, which produced radar sets and bombing antennae, was never bombed. And ironies, as we saw when Senator O'Byrne stood up in the Tasmanian Senate, every time targets were being bombed by the RAF, the gasoline in the RAF's planes was purchased from Standard Oil, which had its royalty agreements with IG Farben. Every gallon of gasoline that the RAF used, Standard Oil and its Nazi German partner received royalties that helped pay for gasoline for the Luftwaffe's attacks on London. I started this evening by mentioning Chaim Weizmann. Is it not ironic that his son was an RAF fighter pilot who was killed during World War II? I'll finish by quoting what three prominent Americans had to say about the issues we've explored this evening. Secretary of Interior X said, "If America loses the war, it can thank the Aluminium Corporation of America." That's a pretty strong statement. Judge Charles Clark said, "Standard Oil can be considered an enemy national in view of its relationships with IG Farben." And I end with President Harry Truman, who said in 1947, he publicly accused Standard Oil executives of being guilty of treason for profiting from the Nazi war machine and for withholding patents from the US government. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much.
People were themselves sending their editors to the Third Reich to meet with Hitler's propagandists to edit out of their films any nasty references or hostile references to Nazism. That's how bad, because they had Germany was the biggest growing market for their films, yeah. And they were not going to damage the market because they were made very clear to them. I just make one other point, actually, to bring it up to date. That I suppose one of the reasons I heard of the Marxist economists, because I spent most of my youth as a Marxist, and I don't apologise for it. I learned a lot, and indeed I think one of the reasons that so much of this capitalist involvement didn't ever become common knowledge was because of how quickly socialism and everything to do with socialism became part of the new enemy. So that, and in other words, it's another one of the things that Stalin has to answer for, was the fact that by discrediting socialism, he discredited Marxist analysis, which I think had a value and still has. I think it's very interesting that at this very time, Saudi Arabia are financing jihadist schools and colleges all over the world, and they are behind financing Islamic State, and yet business continues. It's very much a case of business as usual with Saudi Arabia for a very simple reason. They have the biggest and cheapest supply of oil in the world. So I suppose the most important thing about this very, very interesting and insightful talk, Yanky, is that it has a relevance to today's world and help us to understand what's going on at the moment in relation to the anti-Semitism being one. And I think that was extremely important, identifying the three factors, because I think there's no question about it, that running through all of that was a hard core of anti-Semitism. So thank you again for this.
Thank you. Just as a postscript, I was very surprised at the slashing attack by Fintan Atul in the newspaper about Saudi Arabia. Unusual for anybody in public life in Ireland to put their head above the parapet and say what all of us know, certainly all of us in this room know, and never get said, because it is not politically expedient and it'll ruffle feathers and it might hurt the meat trade and the beef trade and God knows what else. I hadn't actually made the direct parallel. And of course, you're quite right. And I'd even mentioned the propaganda campaign. $200,000 paid to an American company to spread disinformation, anti-Semitic information and pro-German information. And that is not 1,000 miles from the use of Saudi money to pay for schools and institutes and the like. And of course, it was more than strange to watch one of the Saudi princes, I think it was the foreign minister, marching down, shouting, "Je suis Charlie," probably at the same time as this poor blogger was being lashed. There were other strange people on the Paris March. I suppose, you know, we know who they are. And it didn't take the Turkish president very long after he returned home to say that actually the whole thing was a Zionist plot. But then we know that. So he wasn't telling us anything new. But thank you, Oliver, for those comments.